Bienvenidos todos. Presente, me gusta. Muy bien. Si tu fiesta por ahí, en el chat me dejan saber. Se escucha la musiquita, se ve todo bien.
Hello.
Antonio, contéstame, ya que tú estás ahí presente. Yes. Awesome. Hello everyone. Yareli, si me escuchas, por favor, envíales un mensaje en el chat y llámamelos a todos para que vengan otra vez para sessions. Welcome everybody.
Welcome.
All right. Somos las que somos.
Así es.
Very good. Bueno, déjame, voy a poner musiquita. Si quieren, apaguen cámara un momentito porque veo que hay 29 personas. No sé si se fijan, a mano derecha arriba dice 29 y entonces acá mirando está, hay 21, o sea, hay 8 que quizás estén todavía networking. So vamos a darles un breakecito. Mientras vayan llegando, los que estén aquí, avisen. Ven el chat a mano derecha que dice event y hay otro que dice session. Avisen los que están aquí en el que dice session. Asegúrense que en el botón que está a mano derecha, en el chat, tengan apretado la sección de session, porque ahí entonces grabamos todo lo que está acá. Ya estamos en el salón como tal. Bienvenido ya. Recuerden que esto es como un evento, una plataforma más de evento, así que este es el salón donde vamos a estar durante la presentación. Okay. Vamos a dar el último mensajito, Yareli, si me avisas en el event chat y sé específico de que vengan a Sessions y en Sessions le den a Troy. Los que estén aquí, sé que tengo 22 que están acá. Déjenme saber que todo se escucha bien, se ve bien antes de comenzar. Bello. Gracias a todos. All right. Voy a empezar en español rápido con unos, lo que son los housekeeping, los anuncios de housekeeping, como quien dice. Número uno, bienvenido a Hopin. Esto es una plataforma que es para eventos virtuales en el cual ustedes deciden cómo ustedes quieren participar, pero nosotros queremos que participen. Estamos en un salón y todos podemos ver la presentación sin molestar, sin entrar en cámara ni nada, pero la idea es que después de que presente Dave, pues que los más que puedan participen activamente, o sea que después van a poder hacer hop-in a la cámara y para eso hay un botón, si no me equivoco está a mano derecha azul que dice join us to join the session y ahí ustedes después de que termine Dave le van a dar ese botón azul y van a poder hop-in en la conversación. Importante, yo lo voy a repasar en el chat, cuando entren a cámara, denle mute para que entonces, porque acá esto no es como Zoom que podemos mute a todo el mundo, sino ustedes controlan su propio micrófono y nosotros les avisamos entonces cuando estemos listos para escucharlo. Es importante que hagan eso. Nosotros queremos que esto sea algo humano, que sea más allá de una llamada simple, sino que como que queremos que cuando esté el Q&A estemos ahí con él, ¿ok? ¿Me escuchan? En el chat quiero que me avisen los que están ahí, que no estoy hablando sola, me siento sola. All right, entonces también importante, gracias a todos. Importante que sepan que el hopping tiene un truquito y quiero que lo practiquen conmigo, aunque yo voy a estar stop sharing en un segundo, pero la imagen donde está la presentación, ustedes también la manejan. O sea, que si ustedes le dan doble clic a la imagen donde está la presentación, se va a poner más grande. Y ahí entonces van a poder ver todo un poquito mejor, ¿ok? So, saben que le dan doble clic y you maximize the video. Perfecto. All right. Bueno, dado eso, voy entonces a pasar como quien dice en inglés el evento formalmente. Welcome, everybody, and thanks for coming to our first Tech Guru Talk. We want to talk tech. I want to talk tech. I want to learn a lot. I am absolutely honored to have been invited by Sofía, my good friend of Piloto, and Alexandra from EverTech to help, host this event. We've been using Hopin for a little bit. It's not perfect, but I think it has some cool features that make, you know, these virtual events a lot more human. So we're hosting it and we're helping MC, but we want this to be more of a conversation. I am the co-founder of Seriously Creative, which many of you know that we are the post-it kings and queens, the ones that do, you know, strategy and a lot of, you know, brainstormings in a very visual way. So we are very heavy on what's design thinking and design sprints. On the side, as my past life, I used to produce events. So I'm very passionate about the logistics and the technicality of my own events. And it's become a thing, you know, for these virtual events that people have been inviting us to help, you know, manage and structure those as well. So thank you very much again, Piloto and Evertech, for inviting us to kick this off and to be with you along the way on this new journey. And I'm going to hand it off to Sofia. And I think Sofia and Alexandra can actually turn on your cameras already. So, and I'm going to stop sharing. And Sofia, it's yours.
Hola a todos, bienvenidos. Muchas gracias por estar aquí con nosotros en el primer evento de Tech Guru Talks. Yo tengo que decir que cuando nosotros el año pasado hablamos con Alexandra y otros líderes dentro de Evertech, pre-pandemia, ciertamente teníamos una idea diferente de lo que iba a ser este tipo de eventos, pero vimos una necesidad importante en el mercado local y en el ecosistema empresarial, específicamente el de startups y tecnología. Y es que no existían verdaderamente eventos un poco más técnicos, ¿verdad? Donde pudieses aprender un poco más en detalle cosas más técnicas, pero a la vez, si no eres tan techie, poder participar como quiera y entender. Y ese fue el propósito de lo que queríamos hacer en un momento dado presencial, que iba a ser tal vez un evento mucho más grande, que iba a ser parte de la estrategia de innovación que lleva a cabo Evertech, liderado por, en gran parte, Alexandra. Y luego nos encontramos con la pandemia y rápidamente Evertech dijo presente. Vamos a hacerlo, vamos a hacer estos eventos virtuales, vamos a hacer varios de ellos y vamos a aprovechar la oportunidad única de que podemos acceder a invitados internacionales como Dave a que participaran precisamente por el tema de estar todos virtualmente conectados. Así que para mí es un gran privilegio que Evertech haya dicho presente. Yo sé que esta es parte de la innovación que ellos están haciendo dentro de Evertech y que ahora quieren compartir con el resto de la comunidad de startups y tecnología aquí en Puerto Rico. Y me siento bien honrada de que pudimos hacer esto en tan poco tiempo, porque realmente montamos toda una serie en menos de un mes, ¿no es así, Alexandra? Y hemos preparado una lista increíble de invitados que van a hablar desde todo, desde lo que vamos a hablar hoy, que es visualización de datos, hasta AI, machine learning, cybersecurity y muchos otros temas. Así que estamos bien entusiasmados lanzando esta serie virtualmente hoy. Agradezco enormemente la colaboración de Seriously Creative también. Y desde luego, pues, Evertech, gracias por decir presente, por hacer esta serie posible y por lanzar junto a nosotros algo que verdaderamente entendemos hacía falta en el ecosistema. Que vamos a hablar un poco en Spanglish para que también Dave nos entienda. Y tenemos también unos invitados que no necesariamente hablan español. Así que, Dave, thank you very much for agreeing to be a part of this series and kicking off our Tech Guru Talks. We are super excited to have you on board and to see your presentation momentarily. And I had the privilege of seeing Dave speak actually in Puerto Rico. He came down for one of the first tech summits that we ever had on the island. I don't know how many of you remember the tech summits that we had here, but Dave was one of the speakers. And when I saw him speak, he just blew me away. And so it is my privilege and my honor to have you here again with us today, Dave.
And thanks so much, Sophia.
Yes, you're super excited. So with that said, I'm going to hand it over to Alexandra from Evertech, SVP of Marketing and Communications, who will talk to us about Evertech and also about why they decided to launch this important series.
Sophie, hola Jimbil. Hi Dave, nice to meet you. Bueno, como le dijo Sofía, yo soy Alexandra López, llevo en Vertec 2 años y llegué a desarrollar esta estrategia de innovación que hemos, Sofía, hemos trabajado juntos por los últimos 2 años llegando aquí. Así que en nombre de Vertec le doy la bienvenida a nuestra primera oficial sesión de Tech Guru Talks. En esta ocasión hicimos alianza tanto con Piloto, de nuevo, añadimos a mi amiga de hace mucho tiempo, Angie Mill, con Cybersecurity para realizar estas charlas dirigidas a la comunidad técnica y desarrolladores tanto en Puerto Rico como en Latinoamérica, juntándolo con expertos de calidad mundial. ¿Por qué Puerto Rico y Latinoamérica? Porque no sé si todos saben, pero Vertec, aunque tiene sede en Puerto Rico, tenemos oficinas en 11 países, con 2.300 empleados, muchos desarrolladores de background técnico, y servimos a clientes en 26 países, en Puerto Rico, el Caribe y Latinoamérica. No mucha gente sabe la verdad, la grandeza que abarque Vertec, y por eso es importante que seamos, que miramos esto panregionalmente. En Vertec, nosotros creemos en la capacidad de la comunidad técnica de innovar y desarrollar soluciones que hacen lo imposible posible. Para nosotros, el no es una palabra que ponemos sobre la mesa cuando estamos diseñando soluciones, ¿verdad? Y es por esta razón que impulsamos estas sesiones educativas para conectar con ustedes, que todos trabajamos en la industria de tech de alguna manera u otra, más técnicos y menos técnicos, pero todos hablamos el mismo lenguaje en algún nivel. Hoy, pues, como dice Sofía, nos conectamos virtualmente, ¿verdad? Esto era para hacerlo en presencia, pero tenemos que ajustarnos, ¿verdad? Adaptability es una de las cualidades de nosotros, ¿no? Pero con la misma pasión de aprender y ayudar a impulsar ideas innovadoras, nosotros a través de esta sesión lo que queremos es abrir el apetito de conocimiento para que todo el mundo aquí trate cosas nuevas, porque así podemos continuar innovando, como decimos en Vertec, sin pedir permiso. Así que con eso, voy a switch over to English, Dave, and I won't translate everything I said, but it was all very nice. And all leading up to your wonderful chat. I didn't say anything bad about you. Now, Jimmy, keep me honest. So right now, I'm going to switch over to English and introduce our first speaker, Dave Troy. Dave, welcome. Bienvenido.
Thank you.
He's currently CEO and product architect at 401 Labs, maker of the popular email management tools Maelstrom.co and Chuck. He has been acknowledged by the founding team at Twitter as the first developer to utilize the Twitter API with his project Twitter Vision. His current projects use social network data to map cities. His data visualization through social graphs was featured in the 2008 MoMA exhibition Design and the Elastic Mind, curated by Paola Antonelli. Dave is a visionary in using data to map cities and societal needs around it. Without further ado, Dave, I turn the mic over to you.
Thanks Welcome. So much, Alexandra, and thank you all for having me here for this kickoff Tech Guru talk. I couldn't be more excited. So,
I'm going to stop sharing, Dave, just to prepare you to start sharing your presentation. I'm sorry to interrupt, but Alexandra, thank you for your message. We can stay here to, you know, cheer him, you know, as he comes, you know, to the stage, right? And right, Dave, and you come in, you know, really dramatic, right? Yeah, yeah. Or something like that. Yeah. Okay.
Sure, it's a fire.
All right. So as Dave, if you want to start sharing your presentation, that's going to be our cue to then start fading away.
All right. Well, I'll go ahead and start doing that. It may take me set up here, so bear with me.
We don't want to leave him out. Oh, beautiful. All right, now we can start fading away. Sophia, bye-bye. I'll see you later. Alexandra, bye-bye. I'll see you later. I'll see myself later, but I'm going to stick here just in case you need anything technical. Everyone on the chat, please be present. We need your questions at the end of the talk. The best part's gonna be the conversation. I mean, the presentation is gonna be awesome, but look, I'm dying for the conversation. So make sure to take notes and ask questions. You can use the chats or you'll be able to come on board and hop in at the end of a presentation. All right, that said, I'm going to fade away. And Sophia, I'm going to kick you out nicely. Mwah. All yours, Dave.
Okay, so again, thank you for having me here for this kickoff Tech Guru talk. I'm super excited to share all this with you. And today, what I'd like to talk a little bit about is kind of how to make sense of this crazy year that we're having in the context of the pandemic. We have politics because we have a presidential election. We have disinformation and then a lot of existing division that has been building up in our country and in the world over the last several years. So as was mentioned, I spoke in Puerto Rico in 2015, and this is the kind of work that I've been doing. I made a map of Puerto Rico where each dot is a Twitter user and each of those fine lines that you see is a connection between them. And when you put that into an algorithm to lay it out sort of by the using the connections as a guide of where to place things, what you find is that these communities really pop out. And this is something that you can repeat on all sorts of, you know, other data sets like this from, you know, Twitter, from LinkedIn, from Facebook. And you find that these patterns of division keep popping up again and again. And they're almost, you know, they're similar between different places, but they do reflect regional, you know, variations. And I think you would probably recognize that this is sort of what, you know, Puerto Rico Twitter looks like. And it's probably hasn't changed that much even in the last 5 years, because these structures tend to be relatively stable over time. So as I've been looking at this kind of work, it's led me into studying, you know, how divisions manifest themselves in society and in data. And then also how social media can be used to spread disinformation and misinformation. So if you look at misinformation, it's good to be clear about these terms, because sometimes people you know, get mixed up between them. So misinformation is false information that was created without necessarily the intention to cause harm. It could be something like medical misinformation, like somebody spreading a fake cure to a pandemic, for example, or it might be, you know, something that was put out maybe with the intention of making money, but they're not really trying to hurt people. It's just, you know, trying to get something to go viral. Disinformation is a little bit different in that it is created with the express intent of harming the targets. So this is something like, you know, putting out there that, you know, the U.S. government was responsible for the creation of the AIDS virus. That was an attempt to discredit the U.S. government, and it's certainly not true. And that kind of thing can have a major destabilizing effect on democracies when you take it at scale. And I think you could all identify things currently going on with respect to 5G, coronavirus vaccines, et cetera, where people are being harmed by active disinformation and misinformation. So it's also no secret that we're divided. We are a very divided country right now. You know, we've even seen in some data from back late last year that 20% of people in the United States approve of political violence, 25% approve of splitting the country in two. And we've seen this manifest itself in the form of both right-wing and left-wing protests over the last several months. And it seems like that, you know, the distance between us is just greater than it's ever been right now. So within the context of the 2016 election, we saw a lot of stuff starting to float around on the internet, you know, various kinds of disinformation and misinformation. I'm sure that Puerto Rico was not spared, you know, being targeted with this kind of stuff. And, you know, people pretending to be Black activists, people pretending to be Latino activists, across the spectrum. It you know, really runs the gamut to target all kinds of different populations. And to really understand, you know, how we can get so divided, it's actually rather instructive to look at how cults work. And that may seem like a kind of a leap, but if you think about what disinformation actually does create divisions, and it tightens us into these groups. And so if you think about the kind of cult type formations that we're familiar with from culture, you know, on the left, you see Jim Jones, who most famously, you know, had the cult at Jonestown in Guyana, where 900 people perished as a result of their religious paranoia. And in the upper right, you see still from the movie The Godfather, which depicts a mafia, which is a certain kind of cult. Where, you know, they sort of have this extra societal structure that defines how, you know, they conduct themselves. And then in the lower right, you have the Salem witch trials from Massachusetts in 1692. And subsequent sociologists and historians have studied that episode and have concluded it was basically a kind of a cult episode where two groups of people got into a conflict with each other, probably over mercantile interests, and ended up becoming at each other's throats and ultimately having all sorts of delusions as a result of it. So If you think about that initial slide I showed you where each dot is a person and each line is a connection between them, this is how you would represent a cult within that kind of a structure, where each relationship has roughly, you know, a relationship with everybody else in the cult, and they also have a strong relationship with the member, with the leader of the cult. But this is more like what a healthy society might look like, sort of similar to what I showed you at the beginning with Puerto Rico, where, you know, you do have different communities of interest, but they're connected together, and there's a lot of messiness between them, and people aren't so divided. What disinformation tends to do, and the effect on society, is to start to pull us apart into these more finely sorted kind of communities, and more homogeneous and with tighter links between us. And the ultimate end state that you might end up in after many different cycles of this is something that looks like this, where we're just in these separate bubbles and we're not connected to each other at all. Now, we're not quite there yet, but this gives you a sense of how extreme this can become if we just let this grinding of disinformation and misinformation work on us as a society. We will become fully disconnected from one another and, you know, invested in our own groups and not in society as a whole. So when you think about the idea of radicalization, like when you talk about terror groups and, you know, religions and that kind of thing, it really boils down to the idea that radicalization occurs at the moment when your in-group values, your small group values, override broader societal values. And, you know, when that starts to dictate your decision making, you've probably gone past a threshold. And that's kind of where we're heading right now is, you know, if we keep building mechanisms to divide us further and further into smaller and smaller groups, we will end up with a society full of radicals. And arguably, you can see that there is evidence of that happening now. So think about, you know, something like the flat earth people. You know, how much radicalization has to happen before you start to think that, you know, this is the way that things are? You have to be so far disconnected from people who, you know, understand science, who, you know, share a common view of, say, the space program or media or gravity or any one of a number of things, to believe that something like this is the case. And yet there are a lot of people out there that believe that things like this are the case. This is a slide from a friend of mine named Steve Hassan, who has written a lot of books on cults. And he has something he calls the BITE model, which really is referring to behavior, information, thought, and emotional control. And the idea here is just to really illustrate that when you're in a kind of a mixed society that isn't radicalized and isn't divided into small cults, you know, you can have compassion and conscience and creativity and humor and free will. But if you are instead, you know, locked into one of these very tight social capital constructs of a cultish nature, you're going to love only within the context of the cult. You're going to be very concerned about language. You're going to be concerned about, you know, deception and having the ends justify the means, this sort of thing. So these are all, you know, the things on the right, the things that characterize cult behavior. And we start to see this emerging on both the political left and the political right, where, you know, there are really strict rules about what you're allowed to say and not say and all of this. And it just gets to be kind of extreme after a time. So the other thing that people tend to kind of get wrong when they think about themselves in the context of a political and even a technological structure is that they tend to think about themselves as having free will and agency. But the fact of the matter is that you're really surrounded by your friends. You as a person are a social construct, you know, and the things that you believe, it's been studied, actually are the average of the things that the people around you believe. And let that sink in a little bit. I mean, the fact of the matter is that, you know, you don't have a whole lot of individual free will and agency within this construct, because you are basically existing within this this network of social capital that exists between you and your friends. And so for you to become fully radicalized, right, you would end up losing some of those friends. And that would be a way that you could change your friend group and also change who you are, but your intention with your friends. And so, you know, people kind of go around with this thought when I think, in fact, it's a little bit more like we need to think about populations as a collective construct rather than as a individual construct. And how do we function as a, you know, large scale collective organism? So to clarify a little bit about, you know, what disinformation specifically does is it divides us into in-groups and out-groups. It further hardens the boundaries between those groups, you know, because the further we get sort of radicalized and pulled into these rabbit holes, the less we're interested in interfacing with other people around us, or, you know, who are not part of our in-group. It creates this kind of excess social capital within these groups where, you know, people within the groups think that their group is the only valid group, and they don't have necessarily a great deal of respect for people outside of the group. And I would argue that this causes what I call cognitive errors in group decision making. So if you think about political contexts, you know, the political far left was fairly convinced that Bernie Sanders was going to, you know, slide to victory with no problems. And, you know, I would say that perhaps, you know, a little bit more reasoned political commentators were not so sure. And, you know, it's not that the folks on the far left are bad people or wrong or what have you. It's just that they were immersed in an information bubble that was so extreme that they couldn't see, you know, that there were other points of view out there and that this might actually not turn out the way that they think it would. So the other side effect of this is that it turns truth into a kind of a political position. And there is, you know, in the context of these cultish type groups, there's no absolute truth. It's just what does your group believe versus what my group believes. And I think we see that manifested in a lot of our discourse today. So when thinking about this from the standpoint of technology, you know, one of the things that I think that we want to consider is that, you know, we are using these technologies hours and hours and hours a day and, you know, tens of hours, you know, hundreds of hours a week. And it has an impact on our behaviors, and it has an impact on our friendships and how we relate to people and our ability to form social capital in a free way. So from that standpoint, you could actually make the argument that society is programmable in a sense, that we are building tools that are creating a certain kind of society. So, you know, as you kind of get further and further up into the technology stack, those design choices become more and more specific. So from the standpoint of just having computing, you know, that doesn't really dictate very much about what kind of society we have. You know, if it's just a world filled with microprocessors, that doesn't change who we are very much. But when you add on top of that TCP/IP networking, and you add on top of that technology structures like HTML and HTTP and apps, and you add on top of that social media, which mediates how we interface with our friends and family in the world. And then you add on top of that things like newsfeed algorithms and constructs like liking and following, and then the content itself, it starts to change who we are as people and as a society. So if you think about something like an Instagram, what kind of society does Instagram create? And if you think about, you know, like some of the people who are Instagram influencers and that sort of thing, and you think about some of the things that have gone crazy in that world where you've got people like, you know, Lori Loughlin's daughter, you know, paying to get into colleges and whatnot, you know, like you're creating this very fake kind of artificial view of the world. And, you know, we need to, as a society, ask ourselves, do we want to participate in these technologies that make us into a certain kind of person? Or, you know, perhaps even more importantly, as technology designers, we should be thinking about what kind of society does our technology, the things that we're building, what kind of society does that create? And, you know, broadly, if we think about society as being programmable, what should we program it to be? And what is our ethical obligation to, you know, do that in a way that, you know, is taking into account societal considerations? So if you think about something like, you know, the iPhone, which has clearly had huge implications on society, not only through the iPhone itself, but also in terms of the design of things like Android and other similar systems. This has been an iconic game changer, and we are now, as a society, glued to these small glass screens, which is great. I mean, they provide us with such utility and value, but they also are changing who we are. So my only request with, as we design things like this, is what is it doing to our society, and what kind of society are we creating, and is that who we want to be? And, you know, I mentioned about Instagram, you know, and Lori Loughlin, you know, this is the kind of culture that we're creating. And is this what we want? I'm not saying it's necessarily bad. All of it, some of it is outright bad, but you know, is this who we want to be, and is this the best way to go about fulfilling our sort of societal destiny? Now, you know, the other question is with respect to disinformation, what kinds of things are the tech companies doing about it? So, you know, Zuckerberg has been famously ambivalent about, you know, whether or not to remove stuff relating to false claims by Trump and others, and is trying to kind of have it both ways. I'm not sure whether that's going to work out or whether that's especially ethical. I really think the company has lost a lot of value by not taking a stance on stuff like this. I know, I personally have cut back my Facebook advertising spend dramatically because I just can't stomach it. And I feel like that if they did more of the right things, they would actually profit from it. Twitter has started to experiment with, you know, standing up to the president and all this kind of thing. And I think my only feeling is there is they should have done more of this kind of thing 10 years ago. And I feel like that the culture that has been created by the tech companies failing to act on this has created a very toxic atmosphere. And, you know, so you might ask, well, who cares? You know, why does this matter? Well, you know, the fact of the matter is that our inability to have a sane and sound information environment, which is really what we're talking about here in an operational sense, is like, how do we as individuals make decisions? It's making it impossible for us to deal with things like climate. And obviously, this year, it's making it impossible to deal with things like the pandemic, especially in the United States. I found this graph kind of funny. If you had shown this graph to somebody in 2019 about what was going to be trending in the early part of this year, nobody would have understood what on earth is going on. You know, Andrew Cuomo, flower, pangolin. But yet here we are. And one of the things that you see with any kind of crisis like we have with the pandemic is that there's kind of a crisis wave, and then there's usually a wave of disinformation that crops up right behind it. Usually there's a little bit of a lag time, but you know, this event has been no exception, and we have a ton of disinformation that's been floating around. This is some of the early stuff, you know, people talking about, you know, relationships with 5G and chemtrails and Jesus, and you know, the shutdown is bad, and you've seen it all. I'm not going to necessarily go into all this right now because it's repetitive. But, you know, it's been a huge problem. And where we sit right now, this is as of today, is that 30 U.S. states, and I apologize that Puerto Rico is not yet on here, although they do have D.C. So hopefully we'll get you guys onto these charts soon. But, you know, 30 U.S. states have a rate of transmissions greater than one, which means that it's growing in those states. Those would be the pink ones on the right. On the left, it's green. But many of those states have been bopping in and out of the red zone over the last few weeks. And as you well know, the numbers in the United States are just off the hook right now. So we have a real problem, and we really have to be thinking about how we're going to fix this going forward. The other thing we need to be considering about this pandemic is that it's not like we're going to reach something like herd immunity anytime soon. We're in for this for quite some time, it looks like. This is from May, but what it shows is that even in the places that were the most hard hit, which are the areas that I highlighted here, the estimate of total prevalence of the virus is only up to around 16%, and that's in New York. Everywhere else is much lower than that. And nationally, the average is 4.1%. So now we're, you know, 2 months later than this, and we are further along. But I mean, we need to get to something like 60% in order to reach herd immunity. So that would take something on the order of like, you know, 30 months, 24 to 30 months, say. And, you know, if we keep going and doing what we're doing, that's going to take some time. And we don't even really know for sure whether herd immunity is possible. As you know, also, the issue of wearing a mask or not has become incredibly political. For no good reason, but here we are because we're divided. This is what's going on. And the fact of the matter is that, you know, in versions of this talk that I was giving in June, I was a little bit more optimistic because the numbers were actually pretty stable. And so there was a lot of what I would call, you know, sort of hand-wringing around the issue of wearing masks. And, you know, the fact of the matter is that all along during that, around 85% of people actually support wearing masks and were wearing masks and or, you know, social distancing and all of that. So there's also a mismatch between the perception of what we think is going on, which we tend to put in very stark, you know, sort of either left or right kind of terms, when in fact it's more nuanced. But still, you know, the fact of the matter is that as you probably have observed yourself, there is a great deal, a sufficient amount of noncompliance with things like mask orders or, you know, businesses requiring masks, that we are having a real problem now. And, you know, there's really no end in sight. The other thing that was a big event was this Plandemic video that came out in late April, that, you know, claimed that there was this huge conspiracy and that Dr. Fauci was evil and blah, blah, blah. And this woman, Judy Mikovits, was, you know, at the center of this, and she was proven to be kind of a flake. The bottom line is that that video created a huge amount of disinformation and derivative disinformation out in the information environment. And those of us fighting disinformation have had to do quite a lot of work to try to put this genie back in the bottle. And it was not stopped on platforms like Facebook for several days before it had reached millions and millions of people. And same on YouTube. On a sort of brighter note, I wanted to bring up Taiwan, where they have this incredible digital minister named Audrey Tang, who has chosen a strategy of what they call humor over rumor, which is basically trying to, instead of demonizing sort of the left and right in-group, out-group kind of dynamic, they instead use a very self-deprecating kind of humor with a lot of other kind of surrealist elements. So this on the right here is their spokesdog that talks about, you know, that there's no need to hoard toilet paper because each of us only have two buttocks. And, you know, like, it's a little bit crass and silly, but at the same time, like, that's the approach and the kind of tone that they've chosen to take. And they found that it worked incredibly well at keeping Taiwan's numbers very low. You know, I haven't checked in on them in the last couple of weeks, so I hope that they're keeping that up. But, you know, they have been relatively successful. And it's just by really coming at the problem from a very different kind of angle, instead of trying to have everything be all instantly politicized. And you can do that by avoiding certain kinds of language. So again, you know, the goal that I think that we really need to be looking at for, you know, our country and, you know, at our individual states and territories like Puerto Rico, is to maximize total health. And that means making sure that our healthcare systems aren't overwhelmed, that we are saving and, you know, keeping people as many lives as possible healthy and safe, that we're finding ways wherever we can to preserve people's income so that they're not facing financial hardship. And we are also preserving people's mental and physical health. And I think that the best way to do that is to, you know, be very accurate about the way that we're assessing the science, avoid political framing, and then also defend against disinformation. But as you well know, we have a big chore ahead of us with respect to that. So just a few words about what we might expect to see in the remainder of 2020, this crazy year. So one thing that we're seeing is that China and Russia are starting to adopt, well, more properly, China is starting to adopt some of the same tactics that Russia has used for regarding disinformation. And we see things getting a little bit more tense with China. We should probably expect some interference from China in the election. And this is not to paint China in a bad light. I really think that some of the saber rattling with China has been unproductive. I think we have to recognize that China and the U.S. You know, need each other very much, and it would be a wise idea for us to figure out ways to cooperate with each other while at the same time condemning unequivocally situations like what's going on with the Uyghurs. Likewise, Twitter has started to take down some coordinated attacks from China regarding disinformation in Hong Kong. Hong Kong and coronavirus disinformation. The other thing that we have, of course, going on is this crazy, you know, new world of deep fakes and even, you know, cheap fakes. If you recall the video of Speaker Pelosi that was slowed down and made to sound like she was drunk, that did not require any particular special technology or fancy AI, but it still was a very dangerous piece of disinformation. So now there's ways that you can, like, you know, make yourself into Elon Musk for a Zoom call, and that's in everybody's hands now. That's, you know, going to become increasingly problematic. This is another example of what's called generative adversarial networks that shows how easy it is to generate artificial faces. This is merging kind of between a whole bunch of different celebrities. This is a little demo released by NVIDIA. And so you can end up with products like this. This beautiful woman does not exist. This is from a site called thispersondoesnotexist.com that you can go to. And each time you click refresh, it will generate a new face for you. And what's been happening is that people are using these fake avatars as a way to create social media botnets and otherwise bypass you know, people's ability to detect bots because they're not using images that are found anywhere else. They're made up fresh every time. There's also the same ability to generate text. I won't go ahead and read this, but this is a site that was called talktotransformer.com, which has since been taken down, that uses a AI model to generate text. And so I gave it the seed, which you see at the top, which is in blue. And then it generated the text below that. And, you know, the text reads like it's real English. Like, if you didn't know it was written by a you know, a robot, you wouldn't suspect otherwise. But, you know, that's the power of these kinds of generative text systems at this point. So, you know, more recently, we've been seeing some other things rise up. You know, there's this face mask exempt card kind of thing. So people, you know, further politicizing the mask thing. And then there's the Boogaloo movement, which is starting to emerge, which is kind of what I would call like Civil War 2.0 light. You know, people are itching to start a new civil war in the United States. And these people are sort of adjacent to the, you know, white supremacy, alt-right kind of crowd, but they take some care to distance themselves from it. But at any rate, it exists mostly on Facebook. Facebook has been trying to combat it. And it's mostly straight up nonsense, but you know, people are being pulled into it. In terms of the election and what we might expect to see specifically, you know, obviously more disinformation and deep fakes would be things that we might expect. Information noise, you might not be familiar with this term, but it's from a Russian term called infoshum, which is basically like creating celebrity noise articles and or political noise articles that aren't really substantive, but they take up room in the news cycle and make it impossible for people to focus on real things. So maybe, you know, like if you know, something like Mitch McConnell makes an outrageous remark, or, you know, if Miley Cyrus does something crazy, you know, this could end up being, you know, written up into articles that take up room, but really are of no consequence. We probably should expect to see some kind of infrastructure attacks, possibly on power. We might expect email bombs, which email bomb would basically be sending people so much email that they can't find their real email. In the face of that, I happen to make products that can help people solve that if that happens to them. And then also phishing attacks like we saw in 2016. The hacking and strategic release of info, or what people sometimes call hack and dumps, would be something else that we might expect to see, where, you know, people maybe hack somebody's email and then release that like we saw in 2016. And then hacks and attacks on the election infrastructure itself. So things like voting registries, servers used to maybe aggregate votes, and election machines themselves. And then lastly, sowing doubts about the process, which we already have a ton of because the president has been spreading disinformation on that. And so have a lot of other people. So, you know, there are some things that AI can actually help with, where we can, you know, start to detect coordinated and authentic behavior, which is what the social media companies call the orchestration of botnets. We can use it to maybe spot different kinds of information operations. We can definitely use it to detect deepfakes and cheapfakes. We can potentially use it to slow the amplification of viral content. So things like Plandemic don't get out of hand again. We can also detect things like provocations to violence. So if there's a situation where, you know, a city is starting to become perhaps a bit unstable, we can use tools like AI to look for things that might actually be problematic, and hopefully, you know, while maybe not erase them entirely, at least not amplify them so much. And then also look at hacked content for anomalies, and use it to potentially protect infrastructure in real time. So if you wanted to get involved in any of this information or work on disinformation specifically, this site here is one that you might want to check out. It's called CogSec Collab, which is stands for Cognitive Security Collaborative. And the idea with cognitive security is that, you know, the most unsecured thing that we have connected to the internet these days is our human brains. And so we have to be taking special care to make sure that garbage does not get into our human brains. And we have no firewalls, and we have, you know, very open access to people's brains. And, you know, it's one thing to tell people that they should become more, you know, information literate and that sort of thing. And that is, of course, true. But at the same time, there are a lot of things that we can be doing from a tech platform standpoint to keep people from some of the worst effects of this kind of, you know, disinformation effort. And I wanted to close with this, which is, you know, the famous blue marble image of this dear home that we have, and really emphasize the fact that it is up to us to keep this home safe. And, you know, all of the divisions and all of the other little concerns that we have about money and politics and power and everything else all exist on this little blue ball. And we are going to have to figure out some way to get our head straight so that we can deal with the things that we need to deal with. And I think the good news is that, you know, I believe firmly that we have the resources to address almost every concern that we have. You know, the climate challenge is perhaps the biggest thing that we face, but I do believe that we can address it if we can get our heads straight. And so that is going to be our goal, and our you know, mandate is to really figure out how to do that. And I really hope that all of you will join in that ongoing process, because it really is going to demand our full attention. If you'd like to learn more about any of these topics, many of the things that I presented here are synthesized ideas that I've taken from books along these lines, as well as some of my own thinking. But, you know, these books are all very good, and I'd be happy to email this to you if you can't grab this right now. But in terms of really, you know, getting deep down and having a really nuts and bolts level understanding of what's happening to us right now, these books can help you get there. So again, thank you all for having me today, and I'm super thrilled to answer any questions or talk about any ideas that you guys might have.
Thank you so much, Dave, for that. I'm gonna start letting people come in. Remember, as soon as you come in to the camera, make sure to mute yourself, okay? So Karen is in. Everybody who's interested and wants to hop in the camera to start with the Q&A, you may do so now. Dave, I'm inspired and so worried.
Yeah, that's, you know, probably the best place to be. We have a lot of good things and not so good things happening.
So scary. Did you read the messages about how we need firewalls for our brains? How can we purchase that?
Well, you know, I'll let you know when we have one available, but that's the problem is, you know, we're really wide open for this kind of stuff. We haven't given it a great deal of deep thought.
I'm gonna start watching out for the chat, but I have a quick question, and I'm not from the technology world so much, but I mean, who regulates this? Are we improvising every time that there's something that happens ethically with regards to the use of the internet? Do we improvise and react to things, or who regulates this? Where is there a manifesto? I mean, what are we looking at for the baseline, and how often do we update it?
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, to understand that, you kind of have to think about how we got to where we are. You know, there was a great deal of optimism in the early days of the internet that if we just added more people to it, that it would magically create just outcomes. And, you know, that was advanced by people like John Perry Barlow, who was one of the co-founders of the Electronic Frontier Foundation. You know, he had this whole idea of, you know, the independence of cyberspace. And, you know, his ideas really were one of the reasons why the early internet in the 90s was not regulated or taxed. And, you know, I'm not suggesting we should tax the internet or anything like that. But the point is that we had kind of, I think, a very naive idea about what it would be like to, you know, scale this thing up and what would happen. And I think that we got led astray because when the very first people came on the internet, they were all early adopter types and mostly pretty either idealistic or some of them were sort of hippy dippy types. Some were hardcore libertarians, but mostly, you know, the early internet functioned reasonably well. And when it did go off the rails, it was kind of not very many people. And so it didn't have huge outsized effects for the most part. And so we just kind of punted on dealing with some of these questions until recently. And if you look at the kinds of platforms that we're, you know, spending our lives on right now, you know, Twitter, Facebook was designed in 2003, 2004, you know, at least in terms of the initial design and the concept of it. Twitter was designed in 2006. And at that time, that kind of highly optimistic view of the internet was prevalent. And so the thought was, well, we don't have to worry. We just want to build a thing that people can be on and it'll all work out great. And, you know, as we've seen, that isn't necessarily true. So now we're kind of trying to do a midstream course correction and say, oh, well, actually, we do need to worry about what kind of society these tools are creating. But they were never designed with any particular effect in mind. This is, I guess, just what happens every time a new technology comes out, you have to adapt. But, I don't think anybody's really regulating it right now. And we also have to consider that these are global platforms. You know, something like something like Facebook is got more people in it than China. So they kind of walk around like they've got a lot of swagger. And they do to a large extent, but you know, at some point we as self-governing nations need to have a conversation with these platforms about what they are doing to our country. And there's some good things and some very bad things too. So mm-hmm.
I have a comment from Simone on the chat that she wants me to read it so that she wants to look to see your reaction. She says it's a grim prognosis. At this point it seems to be a matter of the survival of the fittest, and I don't think I'm going to make the cut in spite of how hard I try or how smart I think I am. Afraid emoji.
Yeah, I mean, I think that there are reasons to be concerned, and I have to, you know, I would be lying if I didn't feel a great deal of trepidation about where we are right now. But, you know, at the same time, I really feel like that one of the big problems has been that we have not collectively developed a very good understanding of ourselves and where we are with this right now. And, you know, so I feel like that starting to have a better understanding of the diagnosis of the problem is a very, very positive development. And, I feel like that I've worked hard to put together what I think is a framework for understanding that better. And, you know, that kind of framework is starting to get more popularly understood. And there's other thinkers and writers who have started to put that kind of thing out there. I'm writing about this kind of stuff when I can. And I'm hoping.
Can you hear me, Karen? Okay, yeah. I think he hopped out real quick, but
I think
he's
we lost him.
He's coming back on. No, he's right back.
I'm not sure what happened there.
That's okay. No, somehow
disconnected for a second. But anyway, yeah, you know, I think that having an accurate understanding of the problem is a really good development. And I think that we are starting to gain that, and more people that are dealing with, you know, what do we do now are starting to get a better understanding of it. Mm-hmm.
Karen, do you have any questions, or Dana? Mm-hmm.
Question. First of all, thanks, Dave. That was awesome and really insightful and scary. I share Simone's feelings. I feel you shared your take on, you know, that social media companies should be more active in managing the disinformation shared on their platforms. But I wanted to know from you, what kind of tools are they using to fact check whatever is being shared? Is it algorithms? Is it actual people? And what they plan to do and how they plan to implement it, that fact checking, is it actually gonna work, you know, in practice?
Yeah, so, I can't obviously speak to things that are going on that are proprietary, but the things that I know about that they've shared publicly, I can say that they are using a combination of fact checkers as well as doing what they call looking for coordinated and authentic behavior, which basically means looking for botnets. Hang on one sec. Botnets and, looking for patterns of, you know, the same IPs doing a lot of stuff with a limited set of accounts. One of the scary things is the idea that, you know, if you remember that slide that I had about generating text, you know, you could write AI that generates tweets and starts creating a huge flooding botnet of stuff. And like that's if you do it properly, would be difficult to detect, although not impossible, just harder than say some of the things that they're doing now. It's this combination of looking at both the content as well as the tactics and methods. And if you can block the tactics and methods effectively, then that gets you a very, you know, far way along. As far as fact checking is concerned, that is an issue, obviously. And obviously they are using firms as well as, you know, Snopes and, you know, other kinds of sites to say whether things are true or not. you know, truth isn't so much the only issue here, though, because as we've seen, it's very possible to weaponize true information. You know, the right fact delivered to somebody at a key moment could radicalize somebody, just to put it really simply, you know. And so, you know, like, for example, you know, there's various atrocities and things that the U.S. has done throughout the years. And, you know, various aspects of that are strictly speaking true. But if you deliver that to somebody at just the right moment, when they are looking for reasons to hate their own government, that can have an effect of radicalizing somebody. And, you know, so, you know, are you going to say that you can't communicate that? No. But at the same time, if that is part of a coordinated campaign to radicalize people, then you might want to look at that, because that might not be something that's, you know, you want on the platform. And the other thing people need to keep in mind is that there's a lot of discussion about, you know, censorship and that sort of thing. And these are private companies, you know, they don't have to host just any speech on their platforms. They can choose what they want to have on there and what they don't. The First Amendment applies to the government. It does not apply to private companies. You know, I think we also need to be considering, you know, how, you know, part of the reason why these companies don't want to take that role is because they don't have the manpower, and it would cost them an inordinate amount to actually, you know, really moderate content more fully. So that's part of the reason that they're only doing as much as they are.
Mm-hmm. Dana, did you have a question you wanted to ask?
So, yeah, that was terrifying. I think I'm going to stock up on more toilet paper now, water, and climb into the bunker. You know, you're a designer at heart, and, you know, you told us this from a technology and a social media perspective. What do you think are the kind of the new cognitive skills that people and companies need to learn in this world? Because there's no stopping deep fakes. You know, in Japan, there's Melody, which is an AI that flirts with people in like very authentic ways. And there's no stopping the progress of technology. From a designer's perspective, what do people do to be better capable to navigating this world?
Yeah. So, I mean, I think, you know, as always, there's sort of the media literacy and, you know, being discriminating in what you consume and what you do with it that, you know, people advise. And I think that is, you know, obviously never stops being good advice. Always be critical about what you're reading, especially consider, you know, who the sources are and what the intentions of the people producing the information are. And that goes for both, you know, truth and fiction too. You know, it's not just falsehoods that we're looking for here, but what is the intention of the person that's creating the information? What other people are those, you know, creators connected to, and that sort of thing. So I think that's part of it. But I think the other part of it is that, you know, we in the United States have had a very, you know, sort of particular, you know, viewpoint on the world for a long time in terms of, you know, thinking about the individual over collective, you know, societal health and our individual rights. So when people talk about masks infringing on somebody's rights, well, you know, sorry, you know, but I mean, at the end of the day, this is a societal concern, right? So I think we need to start to be a little bit more, you know, cognizant of societal concerns and the fact that we as individuals are not the be all end all of how things function. But in fact, you know, what is our role and our place within the context of, you know, a broader societal network. And I just think we've done a really bad job at kind of creating cultural education around that. So we need to change our culture a little bit. But, you know, that's more than just sort of an admonition, because, you know, I think we are to blame for that aspect. But if you think about it from the standpoint of, you know, what's unseen in the world? What aren't we able to evaluate when we look at the world? It's all of those links between the things, you know, the relationships between people, the social capital that, you know, Sophia and I have with each other. You know, like, these are things that go unseen that do exist, and they shape how our world functions. But because we have had no mechanism to measure things like global social capital and the shape of the networks that we exist in, we simply discount it as just not important. And then that tends to have us put all of our, you know, thinking about individual choice making into the individual and their sense of free will, when in fact, you know, we are bound by this network and all the rules that go into it. And, you know, when you read the New York Times, you need to think about A.G. Sulzberger, and you need to think about, you know, the Dean Baquet and the editor and the network and the people and the relationships and the money that produce the fruiting body that is the New York Times. You know, it's not just like one people doing the thing. It's like this whole network of stuff. So anyway, you know, it's kind of this idea of being able to see the unseen that I think that we just have been completely missing. And I think as we start to become more conscious of that, we'll be better at evaluating how the world functions.
Mm-hmm. I heard you say education, and, you know, how might we, you know, reshape this culture. And I think we need to start early. I mean, we need to start building the ethics of the use of technology from early on, and in order for people to understand also how this affects us as a society. I have any other questions here? Sophia, I have Simone who just joined. Simone, go ahead, welcome.
Thank you. I apologize for the pandemic look. I don't usually look like this.
We all have a good pandemic look.
okay, so from what all you said, what made me think just right now was about the new kind of illiteracy that there is in terms of technology. And let me explain. Everybody has a phone. Everybody has access to Twitter. Everybody has access to a social media platform. And all we have to think behind the information that we receive. For instance, you read something in any social platform, you have to think and you have to discern where is this coming from? What's the intention of the person writing behind it? Is it true? Is it not true? That is literally my work in all the groups that I belong to, for instance, in WhatsApp. What happened yesterday in Beirut, someone in one of the groups posted a tweet from the Prime Minister of Israel, and it was taken out of context. And I went to that account, I read the whole thing, I analyzed it, and I placed it in the chat, and I said, hey, this comment that you posted is out of context. It's a lot of work, and most people don't do it. So what I'm thinking is that there's so much that the general public, from the average people, would have to do in order to discern what is true, what is not, how to approach the information. We are asking a lot from people. So I think besides the effort of telling apart what is true and what is not, how do we approach to minimize or mitigate this new kind of illiteracy? Thank you.
Yeah, so, you know, I think as you say, you know, right now, that's kind of our best defense is to, you know, evaluate stuff as we get it and do that work. And there's people like you and me and many others, I'm sure, on this, you know, call that are doing similar things in their communities. That is a huge amount of work. I think that we need to get to a point where we are considering this from a cultural standpoint. And how do we make our culture less vulnerable to picking up stuff like that and spreading it because they somehow or another want it to be true? And that gets into people's susceptibility to conspiracy theories and that sort of thing. You know, only a sick, unhealthy society is very susceptible to conspiracy theories. And I you know, there's got to be some public health way of thinking about this where, you know, like if you have more than 20% of your population susceptible to conspiracy theories, just to pick a number out of a hat, you have a public health crisis that you have to deal with. So I would argue, just based on my study of this stuff, that that requires cultural rewiring. And by rewiring, I mean changing the formation of social capital within a country. So just as an example of a macro level thing that could have an effect like that, you know, think about the effect of World War II and also, you know, the Korean War and the GI Bill, where you had a lot of different people from a lot of different parts of the country mixing together and getting to know each other as individuals and peers and working in life and death situations. That created a great deal of ongoing social capital within that generation that mixed across rural and urban lines and through a great deal of other divisions that we have in our society as well. Since the 60s, we have largely started to abandon that kind of an approach. And, you know, instead we are sorting ourselves into ever more finely, sort of sorted pockets of people with very similar interests. So if, you know, I can tell you within 66%, accuracy, if you live in a rural area, then you probably are voting Republican. If you live in an urban area, you're probably voting Democrat. And it's because we have sorted ourselves so much that that's true. And not only have we sorted ourselves politically, we've sorted ourselves, by class and race and income and a whole bunch of other things too. So, you know, if you think about even college isn't the kind of mixing experience that it used to be, because people are going to colleges that are name brands to them, you know, that put them with other people that are just like them, because one of the things we found is that education and fashion are essentially the same thing in terms of how people identify with the brand names. And it's one of the reasons why there's a connection between fashion and politics. I mean, it's all kind of the same thing. So we have this cultural sickness where we've just divided ourselves up too much, and we don't have that kind of cross-cutting social fabric that confounds some of these bad instincts. And I really believe that if we introduce something like national service, not necessarily a military draft at all, but something like national service, which is what Stanley McChrystal has been arguing for, we would go a long way towards solving not only some of these sorting problems, but also things like obesity and other things that, you know, are in many ways social diseases. You know, we really need to be considering that. And I feel like that, you know, this country was started with so many existing divisions and challenges having to do with geography and, you know, labor and things like that. We need to do a better job of figuring out how to make ourselves more resilient. And that is what we've failed to do. So just one closing comment on that is that, you know, I will quote Andrew Breitbart, which I rarely do, but he made the comment that politics is downstream from culture. And if you want to have an impact on politics, you need to have an effect on culture. And they have been very effective at attacking different parts of the culture to achieve different kinds of political effects. And I would argue that those of us who perhaps come from a more, you know, liberal Western values kind of tradition, we need to do a better job of figuring out how to, you know, create a culture that generates the kind of political outcomes and health outcomes that we want.
José, creo que tienes, si puedes darle mute un momentito, porque tienes mucho feedback en la parte. La parte de atrás. Este, Dave, actually, I wanted to, I had an idea, Simone. I felt there's parallels with what you are talking about to, how do we manage all that misinformation? And I thought, you know, it's like contact tracing. It's almost like, it's a wild idea, but what if we were to crowdsource like a whole bunch of people to be, you know, to be watching out for this stuff and debunking. I mean, I know there's sites for this, but I mean, it's almost like contact tracing. You have to be, you know, so aware and, you know, and market and red flag and let everybody know. I mean, and it's a lot of work. And they say actually in psychology that it takes 3 times the effort to fight a negative comment or something that's, you know, that affects us as a society. So we have to put 3 times the effort, and we have to put 3 right things on top of that to be able to start, you know, clearing that effect. So yeah, in order for us to save ourselves and not have to go in the bunkers, we need to put a lot of effort.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And there are a lot of strong parallels between this problem and the virus problem. And I think that it's wise to recognize those. I mean, the way that it spreads, kind of resistance by certain networks to, you know, take measures against it. I mean, there are a lot of parallels. And I think that, you know, we can learn a lot by looking at epidemiology as we fight this. But to your point, there are a lot of groups that are working on this problem in different layers. And I can be happy to connect anybody that's interested if you want to work on this problem some. There's at least, you know, 4 teams that I can think of that are working on different contexts, and they're looking for money and stuff too. We're trying to figure out how to scale this up and you know, ultimately help the social network companies manage it, but also, you know, get more of this kind of stuff into other parts of society too, where it is, you know, also a problem. It's not just an online phenomenon.
Beautiful. Jose, I think that you're here because you have a question. Do you have a question, Jose, you would like to ask? Maybe he can hear me. Okay, he's hanging up. Sophia, do you have
any questions? No, gone.
Ah, okay, okay.
Go ahead, Jose.
I do not have a question.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, I think I saw something with Belen, Sophia.
Yeah. Dave, thank you so much. You're incredible.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I loved your presentation. So I think a lot of us in the last couple of days have been seeing the sort of now viral video of the reporter on HBO of debunking the way that President Trump presented information, right?
Right.
And so I wanted to get your take on that and how can more people and designers as well, right, really look at information in different ways and perhaps spread misinformation and disinformation with some facts, but really just by virtue of not including the whole picture, right? Which right. is part of it, because mm-hmm. when you visualize data, data points can be standalone, but if you take them out of context, then all of a sudden you don't have the entire story, right? And mm-hmm. we obviously all understand this. And yet, if it hadn't been for that reporter really pushing back, taking a look at that graph and saying, hey, you're not looking at this data in terms of the population, you're looking at it in terms of just cases, right. then it would have been just another instance where we would have spread more disinformation.
Right. Yeah. So, you know, I think that one of the things we need to think about is what is the nature of information itself? Claude Shannon, who is the founder of information theory and who had a mathematical formal definition to what information was, concluded that information is, you know, data which helps to reduce uncertainty. And if you think about it from that standpoint, that. You know, that basically means telling you something you don't already know, if you think about it from that standpoint. I would maybe go to a different place with what information is and think about it in terms of how it affects its target when you're talking about humans. So what is the effect that this is going to have on the person? Now, the information could be, or the data could be true information, it could be false information, it could be framed a certain way, it could be framed some other way, but what is the effect that it's going to have on the person? And I would argue that the information is the effect. Which, you know, is maybe a riff on Claude Shannon, maybe it's a riff on Marshall McLuhan, I don't know, but I haven't heard anybody talk about it that way, except in the context of like propaganda, there's some discussion about effects of propaganda. But to me, that gets at what your point is that, you know, what was the effect that Trump was trying to have by presenting that information in that way? He was trying to get people to look at it and see it in a certain frame. And the reporter correctly called out and said, no, that frame's nonsense, and, you know, here's why. And I just think that, you know, we need to do a much better job of thinking about what the effects of information are. So what I'm always looking at when I try to evaluate something online, and, you know, I would be lying if I said I was perfect at this. I mean, everybody gets tripped up by something now and again where you think, you know, something is turns out to be bad that you think is good initially. You know, look at where it's coming from and what the intention is and what the effect might be. If the effect is going to be, you know, to be something that's going to be sensational and get people reactive and that sort of thing, then there's a pretty good chance that that's nonsense and or harmful, and you want to be thinking about it from that standpoint. So,
love that. Thank you.
Sure thing.
It says, I would love to know more about your work in social media data and mapping cities and how that might be used to better society, as well as his as well as your experience in visualizing this kind of data.
Yeah, so like I showed you at the beginning of the presentation, I, you know, done things like map Puerto Rico, and I've mapped cities like Baltimore and a bunch of other cities around the world using data from things like Twitter. Initially, I was able to do some stuff with Facebook and LinkedIn as well, which was interesting. That whole situation has taken kind of a crazy turn with the advent of the Cambridge Analytica scandal, because while I was sitting there looking at those kinds of data relationships, thinking about how we could make the world a better place, Cambridge Analytica was thinking about how to manipulate, you know, voters and do all kinds of nefarious things. And so a lot of the sort of doorways through which it's been possible to get some of that kind of data have either been closed or very much tightened. And that's a good thing, probably, because it means that, you know, we are maybe a little bit less open to that kind of manipulation. But, you know, what it showed me was that, you know, a city like Baltimore, you know, is extremely divided, you know, from a psychographic standpoint between, you know, black and white, rich and poor, and that sort of thing. And of course, we know that from things like census data, but to see it mapped out in terms of relationship data has been very interesting. And my thinking is that if you have a sense of how that functions, then you have a better mental model for how that city works, and you have a better ability to think about interventions that might help to bring people closer together and to create social capital between people that otherwise don't have it. So, you know, that kind of work is continuing. I'm trying to do projects in that space where I can that actually make sense, and, you know, where there's funding and that sort of thing. But again, getting the data is a giant project. you know, I have to have a very good reason to do it right now because it's just such a huge pain. And then also, you know, I've also found that it doesn't, like, the structures don't tend to change very much over time. They tend to be fairly stable in terms of, like, the communities and the relationships between them. So once you've kind of read a place, you kind of have a pretty good sense of how a place functions. But, you know, there's always more to learn and different insights that pop up when you map a new place. And the only challenge there also is that as more and more people get onto these networks, it's very difficult to map more than about 100,000 nodes and relationships. Well, 100,000 nodes and the relationships between them at a time. So it can be run into resource constraints there. And there's computational reasons why that's difficult to scale up beyond that. Not impossible, but it becomes a much, much, much bigger deal. So.
Beautiful. There's another question here that's President Trump recently announced his intentions of banning TikTok. What does this mean to the US, and how does it impact content creation, et cetera?
Well, you know, I mean, asking anybody to comment on what's going on inside President Trump's mind is kind of a fool's errand. But, you know, I think that, you know, there is obviously some kind of an effort underway to have it be acquired by Microsoft. I don't know what that means in terms of, like, I assume they're going to try to repatriate, you know, the servers that serve the U.S. You know, I don't know what the relationship with the, you know, the company in China would be after that, or whether there's interoperability, or who knows. I'm sort of waiting for reality to assert itself and learn more about it. But, you know, one thing that I think that we should be thinking about is that one reason why something like TikTok poses a national security risk isn't just because, you know, facial recognition and, you know, other kinds of metadata that people may get in China, but also, you know, we're exporting all the, like, relationships between people in the US to China. And that allows for the kind of political manipulation I talked about before. And we should be cognizant of that. I also see that, you know, Russia is becoming more concerned about, you know, having companies like Facebook do business and Russia for the same reasons. And we may find ourselves in a world where we have national social networks that do not interoperate across countries at some point, or at least if they do, they do so with, you know, very clear rules about where data is domiciled and what data is allowed to be transferred between countries. And if you think about, you know, like the rules on exporting encryption algorithms, you know, have historically been parallel to arms license exports or arms license export law. And if you think about what a social graph represents, it is very much, you know, the keys to how your country functions. And we have to understand and, you know, how that works and be very careful about who we export that to. I'm not suggesting an alarmist kind of an approach, but just we need to be careful about what it is we're doing, because it's very easy to manipulate people once you understand how they're connected.
Any other questions from the people here? Sophia?
Yeah, I have a question.
Nina? Mm-hmm. Go ahead, Jose.
Okay. Thank you for your presentation, David. I'm from Mexico. I'm not from Puerto Rico, but but currently I'm living here in Puerto Rico. And in my opinion, we need to create a community to help Puerto Rico as a big community and getting together the people from USA and the people living here in Puerto Rico. Actually, in my opinion, there are more people living outside of Puerto Rico than there are Puerto Ricans, but they are not living in Puerto Rico, and maybe they are not helping Puerto Rico. So in your experience as a community builder, what would be a good recommendations to have like a bigger community for all Puerto Rico, including Puerto Rico living in Puerto Rico and the Puerto Rican living in mainly in the big cities representing bigger communities in the States. That means New York, Florida, Texas, maybe Chicago.
Sure. Yeah. No, I mean, I think the Puerto Rican diaspora has to be huge. And as you say, probably many times greater than the number of people currently living in Puerto Rico. I would imagine that there's a bunch of, you know, existing kind of like Facebook groups and other kinds of networks that you could probably activate. But, you know, perhaps coming up with some kind of unified message for like, you know, what kind of efforts might be useful for strengthening Puerto Rico and appealing to those people's sense of, you know, their own personal legacy and their background, you know, to get them engaged might be a reasonable thing to do. You know, that seems like the kind of thing that could be maybe done, you know, as a kind of a design challenge, you know, where you figure out, you know, what kind of messaging and, you know, effort, you know, logos, all that kind of stuff that might be appealing to get people engaged. And then I think coming up with good narratives to figure out, you know, how to motivate people to, you know, contribute, whether that's, you know, time or talent or social capital or what have you. Sounds like a great idea, but yeah, I mean, that's just some ideas off the top of my head without knowing, obviously, you know, what existing things exist and mapping that out, it would probably also be a good idea.
Thank you so much for your question, Jose.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. I have a question here from Benin or Benin, sorry. Will there be a point where technology will be restricted because it will seem too dangerous?
There's, you know, some things coming around on that, you know, like I'm not super up on like what the conversation on that side is. But yeah, there are some people, you know, raising concerns about, you know, who has access to deepfake technology. There's, you know, like Adobe makes some tools in that domain that there's a thought process there where if it's created by that tool, they need to also produce a tool that detects it. So there's kind of like a symmetry kind of aspect where people are saying, if you're going to create tools to create it, you have to create a tool to detect it. There is some concern about some of these text engines, and then them getting to kind of too many people. And there, if you Google this, there were some, instances last year where, technology that was kind of released at first was kind of backpedaled, in fear that it was going to get into the wrong hands. So I don't know that it's going to necessarily be restricted, but it, or like legally, you know, regulated, but it might well be that, you know, companies are, and we've also seen companies like Amazon, you know, decline to allow their face detection stuff to be used by police for at least some period of time. So yeah, you know, there's concerns about that, but I don't know where it's going to head.
Dana had a comment that says, do companies need a chief ethics and truth officers? Just
yeah,
joking.
I mean,
joking,
I don't know about
not joking.
Truth, because again, that's so subjective, but
true.
And it's not subjective, but it's also not the only, it's not strictly the problem. But ethics, I think extremely, you know, is extremely important. And I think that, you know, we have not given very much thought to this whole idea of like, what are the effects of my company on society? There's a guy, Tristan Harris, who's fantastic, who was, I think, a design ethicist at Google. If not a design ethicist, that was effectively what he was doing. And he left because he didn't like the effects that, you know, the company was having, and he didn't think they were taking it seriously enough. to mitigate them. And so people like him and Roger McNamee, who have taken up kind of a crusade against Facebook, you know, and other people like Evgeny Morozov and Jaron Lanier, have, I think, articulated very well the kind of ethical concerns that, you know, exist within companies. There's people like BJ Fogg, who was at Stanford, and he was part of this effort to really understand, you know, how to make apps addictive and how to promote these kinds of viral addiction loops. And he's, you know, gone on the record saying he regrets much of his work, or at least some of his work, because, you know, people like Kevin Systrom, you know, who founded Instagram, was one of his students and went on to use that stuff to great effect. And again, not that it's bad, but it just maybe wasn't so fully thought through. You know, it was sort of like hackers thinking about how to hack the human mind without thinking about what the implications were. So I think all that stuff needs much, much higher consideration in companies.
I have now, when I said we had one last question, and now people are asking all the questions. Okay, so I have Karen.
That's how the same question me and Vanjie have.
Okay, so do you want to read it, Karen? Go ahead.
Sure. How do you engage technical people that are very fact-oriented into that community of hearsay? You know, do you think there's going to be an isolation risk? Like me, for example, I've heard all this, and I just want to delete my social media apps.
Yeah, I mean, this is an interesting question, because, I mean, I think that, you know, we don't want to sort of, I think, get overreactive about some of this stuff. I think, you know, figuring out ways to kind of meet people where they are and, you know, gently course correct towards a more sane world is, you know, kind of what the goal is. I think that one of the, you know, just to be really honest about it, you know, like I don't participate on a daily basis on like Twitter. And the reason for that is because I find it to be kind of an echo chamber, and I find it to more and more over the years resemble kind of a game, where, you know, the rules of the game are say something either outrageous or that, you know, very much validates the viewpoints of a lot of people on Twitter, and hope that you get a lot of likes and retweets, and then wash, rinse, repeat. And, you know, with the idea that each time you get more likes and retweets, and not some kind of ratioed tweet, you know, you've done a good job. Like, and so you get a little pat on the back from Twitter. I find that that tends to change people's thought processes. You know, that they tend to then start thinking about, you know, well, what would make a good tweet? Oh, well, maybe I'll tweet this. And then they kind of, the more and more time they spend on the platform, the more that their thoughts and their, thought processes are sort of altered in that direction. And so, you know, I kind of feel like that part of this is like, how do you keep people rooted in kind of reality and not this like LARPing, you know, live action role playing type thing that we have going on a lot of social media. I tend to prefer to use Facebook a little bit more than I tend to prefer Twitter, not because I like Mark Zuckerberg or aspects of Facebook, but because more of the people that I know in real life or that I could know in real life are there. And so it tends to be a little bit more reality oriented for me. As where when I go on Twitter, it's kind of the wild, wild west of all kinds of things. And, you know, like I don't find it enjoyable at this point to spend time there. You know, I wrote an essay about this, which I was pulling up, which I'll post a link to, about Twitter and radicalization. And I think, you know, that process of like constantly like seeking new social capital within a very narrow domain and refining your message to find more of it, and et cetera, is a radicalizing process. And so I think that, you know, like how do you stay grounded in reality while still participating in this stuff, but not get radicalized, is kind of the sweet spot of where I think people want to try to be.
Simone keeps with her frustrated emojis, so you have to see her comment. anybody else? Any other questions? We're wrapping up as we, it's almost 7:15. Sophia, anything else?
I think if there are no more questions, you know, I just, again, thank you, Dave. This has been fantastic, very enlightening in many areas. And we are super delighted to have you kick off this series. I just also want to take the opportunity to invite all of you that are here today to our next Tech Guru Talk, which will take place August 19th on this same platform. Now you guys are all pros, so next time you'll know the drill, which is great. And I also want to thank our sponsors and partners. So thank you very much, EverTech. Karen is here representing EverTech, and obviously thanking Alexandra and the rest of her team for making this investment in this idea that really is a big ask in these times. Not many companies are investing in talks for the community that are open and free to the public. So we thank you for. And finally, of course, Seriously Creative, Angie and Dana, you guys are amazing. We love to have you as partners in Piloto, and we look forward to many more talks in the future. So thank you again, David. That was amazing.
Thank you.
And we are going to be sharing this with some of the other people that registered that weren't able to make it tonight. And hopefully more people will benefit from the incredible talk that you just gave. So thank you again.
Thanks again. It was great to be here.
Before we go, I would just like to thank again EverTech and Piloto for inviting us to be part of this. For all of you who registered into Hopin, now you know for the next one, you don't have to register into Hopin. All you have to do is get your tickets. So I hope that you liked the platform, and stick around because we're not done yet. We're done with this part of the talk, but if you want to hang out a little bit longer and network one or two more times and meet other people, you may do so. So all you have to do is when we're done here, go to networking and hit that blue button once or twice and meet someone new. I think that's part of what we want to do. I mean, first of all, we need to get out of our homes. We need to meet new people. And after a conversation such as this, which I found extremely like an eye opener, specifically that part of the ethics, you know, and the controls. I mean, if you want to go ahead and share that with someone else, go ahead and do so. So we're going to have the platform open for another half hour. Enjoy it. And I'll see you for the next one.
Yes. Thank you.
Awesome.
Thanks again, guys.
Thank you. Thank you, Dave.
Bye now.
So the gathering is officially adjourned. I'm going to go ahead and put some music on and get ready for the rest of the night. Enjoy.
Thank you.